Welcome to the American Cathedral in Paris on this seventh Sunday of the Easter season, the Sunday that comes immediately following the Ascension. This is a Sunday in which we celebrate the promise and Jesus' stated desire that we might have his joy completed in us, yes, even in these difficult times. That will be the focus of our worship life this morning. Wherever and whenever you are, you have a spot in the front, very, very front pew for our worship this morning, in our pre-recorded worship, as you've become accustomed to throughout this time of the pandemic. In the weeks ahead, we are going to begin making a transition to a live stream online as an online offering of our worship. So you will continue to be at the very heart of our worship life, week in and week out. But that over the coming weeks may look different. We wanted to give you an opportunity to prepare for that, to know that, to offer up this opportunity whenever you can to let us know what this mode of online worship has meant to you and how we can continue to serve your spiritual life as we transition week in and week out through the new ways that we will live transitioning through this time of pandemic. Welcome once again.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Let us pray. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Glory, glory to God.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, the King of glory, you have exalted your only Son, Jesus Christ, with great triumph to your kingdom in heaven. Do not leave us comfortless, but send us your Holy Spirit to strengthen us and exalt us to that place where our Savior Christ has gone before, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, in glory everlasting. Amen. Amen.
A reading from the Acts of Apostles. In those days, Peter stood up among the believers, together the crowd numbered about 120 people, and said, "Friends, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit through David foretold concerning Judas, who became a guide for those who arrested Jesus. For he was numbered among us and was allotted his share in the ministry. So one of the men who have accompanied us during all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day when he was taken from us, one of these must become a witness with us to his resurrection." So they proposed to Joseph, called Barsabbas, who was also known as Justice, and Matthias. Then they prayed and said, "Lord, you know everyone's heart. Show us which one of these two you have chosen to take your place in the ministry and apostleship, from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place." And they cast lots for them, and the lot fell on Matthias, and he was added to the 11 apostles. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Jesus prayed for his disciples, saying, I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you, for the words that you gave to me, I have given to them, and they have received them, and know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I am not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one. While I was with them, I protected them in your name that you have given me. I guarded them, and not one of them was lost except the one destined to be lost, so that the scripture might be fulfilled. But now I am coming to you, and I speak these things in the world, so that they may have my joy made complete in themselves. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. I am not asking you to take them out of the world, but I ask you to protect them from the evil one. They do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. As you have sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. And for their sakes I sanctify myself, so that they also may be sanctified in the truth. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Lord, I was with joy surround me, earth and heaven reflect thy rays, stars and angels sing.
Let us pray. Help us, O God, to become masters of ourselves so that we might become servants of others. Take our minds and think through them. Take our lips and speak through them. Take our hands and work through them. And take our hearts and set them on fire for your love's sake. Amen. This music that immediately preceded my sermon this morning
Joyful, joyful, we adore thee, is a tune that is maybe the most iconic, certainly up there in the whole canon of all of Western music that comes from the final chorus, the very ending of Beethoven's Ninth Symphony. And I don't know about you, but hearing that tune and hearing those words all put in combination in this time that we're living through right now, it doesn't sit quite right. It doesn't feel quite right to be proclaiming joy in the midst of all that we've been living through. But this Sunday, this day, yes, in this hymn that traces back to Beethoven, and especially in this gospel that traces all the way back to the very first century AD, confronts us with the reality and the message in the gospel that we are meant to live joy and joyfully. Joy is Jesus's desire, the gospel says, that we might have his joy made complete in us. We don't just hear it today in this reading from John's gospel. We had it last week as well. Jesus says it not once, but repeats it again to emphasize just how important the completion of his joy in us is for him. But in this time, in this day, the challenge that we have is just how taboo joy feels in our lives. When we think about joy now, we either think so often, what has there been or what is there to be joyful about with so much having been lost, so much yet ahead that is anticipated but isn't here yet? Or at the same time, when we do feel joy, when we do feel like we have a reason to be joyful, there's this question about whether it's okay or appropriate to feel that joy because of all of the loss that surrounds us, let alone to express it beyond ourselves to others. It just doesn't feel honest or even rational to be joyful these days. That's the experience of being human in 2021. But Jesus makes it clear we have to deal with today that his desire is for us to have joy, and that Jesus' joy is to be made complete in us. Now, let's also acknowledge that we have a state of exhaustion, or contributing to the exhaustion of what we're living through right now, is the fact that even when we have joy, those things that we're used to having or ways that we're used to expressing joy in our life, we're being deprived of being in the company of others and sharing gestures and being able to express with wonder and excitement. We're denied all of these things by what we must do to keep one another safe in these times. I have to admit that one of the hardest parts of my job here at the cathedral and for these last few months has been greeting people for in-person worship on Sunday morning and coming out before the service starts to remind people that there are things that they cannot do. They can't greet one another with gestures of peace, and most especially, they're not supposed to sing, which is one of the most fundamental ways that we express joy. And last Sunday, we finished our service with one of my most favorite hymns, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling, which to me, even walking out, I could feel palpably the joy that that hymn connects me with, of God's love, the promise of God's love that exceeds all known boundaries, even death. I just have such a hard time keeping my own self from singing it. This is the reality of the time that we are living in. And yet, we are meant to continue to find ways to express and to live joyfully. We are living in the tension between the rationality that we have that loving one another means refraining from doing things that are joyful, but it's loving to refrain from them, while at the same time acknowledging the irrationality that is joy itself. And we're reminded that joy in and of itself is not a rational experience, but it is fundamentally truthful. If we think about times when we experience joy, it defies explanation and understanding. And there's something that when it comes to us that just feels true all the way down to our bones. We couldn't explain necessarily to anyone else exactly how it came to us or exactly how it felt or even exactly what it meant. We just knew that we felt it and we couldn't help. We could barely contain it. I suspect, and I certainly hope that you've had that experience and that you haven't forgotten it or what it feels like, even for as long as we've had to live the lives of restrictions that we've been in. It doesn't help, actually, in being confronted with Jesus' desire that we have joy. It doesn't help that we struggle with joy as it is, actually. We struggle with joy in a few different ways. First, so often we conflate joy with happiness, such that we forget that joy is not the absence of suffering or difficulty, more like happiness is, that happiness is so often the lack of things that are bad in our lives or difficult, but rather that joy is an expression of the power of life and of love in the midst and in spite of suffering and difficulty. That's what makes joy so powerful. Another thing that we struggle with joy is that we think actually that we can have joy without difficulty. But that's also not true. We forget, going back to our music this morning in Beethoven's Ninth Symphony and this powerful tune melody that's been passed down from generation to generation and continues to be so powerful. We forget that in the context of that Ninth Symphony, that melody doesn't come until the very end. And all that precedes it is not necessarily joyful, but an expression of endurance and perseverance and the power of being present to that and bearing witness to the difficulties of life. And it's only out of that that at the very end there's this explosion of exuberant joy in this hymn tune that we have this morning. Joy comes out of times of difficulty and challenge and suffering, not for lack of it. And the last challenge that we have so often with joy is that we judge it. When we look at people who manage to express their joy, and this was true for us even before the pandemic started, let's be honest, so often we look at joyful people and we say, well, clearly those people don't get it. Clearly those people aren't living in the reality that I'm living in this world, that I see of all of the pain and the suffering. If they really connected with the world as it really is, they couldn't possibly feel that way. For the sophisticated and the cosmopolitan types, we struggle with that. And so we look at that, and as smart, sophisticated people, which, let's be honest, if you're coming in some way, shape, or form to the American Cathedral in Paris, you are a sophisticated person. We know when we look at the world as sophisticated people, we know when we look and we see something that seems too good to be true. And more often than not, when we see joy in the world that we live in the world that feels real to us, we look at joy and we say, that's too good to be true. And we hold it at an arm's length. But the truth is actually true. Some things are, in fact, too good to be true. Father Greg Boyle, the founder of Homeboy Industries in Los Angeles, California, to this date, the most successful rehabilitation program for former gang members, he writes in his book entitled Barking to the Choir that the truth about God is that God is too good to be true. And whenever human beings bump into something too good to be true, we decide it's not true. If there's anything that's more painful for so many of us than living a joyful life, it's being told that we're wrong about something. And given the choice, we might rather go on living lives without joy than accept that we were wrong, that joy is too good to be true. For what is the truth, according to Father Boyle, of God? It's that God, he says, created us because God thought we would enjoy it. That God is absolutely exhausted from delighting in us and loving us just as we are, just as we live. That is the truth that absolutely does. If you're like me, even hearing those words right now seems too good to be true. But my friends, it absolutely is true, and it is the source of our joy. It's a truth that grinds at us and it disrupts us. It is a disruptive idea, joy. But the irony is that even at, no matter how disrupted we are and how put off we can be when we encounter joyful people, the truth is also that we are profoundly attracted to joy. Think for just a minute about someone that you've encountered in your life. It may be someone, just an ordinary person that you encountered on the street, or someone, a public figure that to you embodies joy. I know that you've encountered people that just radiate joy in their lives to such an extent that you look at them and say, how can that even be real? That can't be true. I think about people. I think of someone in the choir at the church that brought me to the Episcopal Church. There was someone who at first I never knew him. I looked at him. He sang in the choir. He always stood in the very back row. And my God, no matter almost whatever it was that was being sung, he just exuded the love of God. He was having an ecstatic experience right there singing in the midst of the worship service in a way that you couldn't ignore. And you'd look at it and say, I don't know who that is, but that can't be real. Well, I got to know him over the course of my time there, and the truth was that it was very real. And the reality of his life wasn't always wondrous and perfect and happy, but he was always connected to that joy, and he never went up there to sing without being connected to that joy in such a way that you could see it and feel it. We know people in our lives like that. And they radiate a truth that seems like it seems way too good to be true. They just can't be exactly that way. But all people who appear that way connect to this profound truth of joy. That our joy is rooted in Christ, that suffering and death absolutely never have the last word. The truth is that the worst things that have happened to us, and even the worst things that we ourselves have done, do not define us. That is a truth that is too good to be true, but is promised to us through Jesus in the gospel. A gospel of love and compassion that knows no bounds, not even death. And so our joy is the affirmation of that truth, and the truth that love and life are stronger than any and all things, stronger than guilt, stronger than shame, stronger even than death. Joy is the expression that the realities of sadness and of evil and of death and of depression are so very real, but they do not, and they will not, and they will never carry the day, thanks to God. The gospel does not promise us a perfect life or a life free of pain and suffering. Rather, the gospel promises us a more joyful life, not a perfect life, not a pain-free life, but a joyful one. And my friends, Even in the midst of a time like this, if we do not have joy in our lives as Christians, then we are not doing this thing right. For Jesus does not want us to be known for our piety. And God knows Jesus doesn't want us to be known as his followers for perfection. Jesus wants us to be known by our joy, to be those people out in the world that other people look at and say, that can't be true. That looks too good to be true. And at the same time to say, I want what she's having. Joy is powerful because it looks at the world exactly as it is and dares to assert something that is too good to be true. That there is more than the pain that we see and experience. There is more than the suffering in this world. Joy is the assertion that there is nothing greater and nothing stronger than God's love. It isn't rational, but it is truthful. And it is the source of our joy, something which can never, ever be taken away. God created us because God thought we'd enjoy it. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia. Amen.
Now standing, we affirm the faith of the Church in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
With all our heart and with all our mind, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above, for the loving kindness of God, and for the salvation of our souls, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the world, for the welfare of the Holy Church of God, and for the unity of all peoples, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our bishop and for all the clergy and people, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the leaders of the nations, and for all in authority, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the city and for every city and community, and for those who live in them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For seasonable weather and for an abundance of the fruits of the earth, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the good earth which God has given us, and for the wisdom and will to conserve it, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who must travel in the midst of this pandemic, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the aged and infirm, for the widowed and orphans, and for the sick and the suffering, especially those suffering from COVID-19, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the poor and the oppressed, for the unemployed and the destitute, for prisoners and captives, and for all who remember and care for them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have died in hope for the resurrection, and for all the departed, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For deliverance from all danger, violence, oppression, and degradation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That we may end our lives in faith and hope, without suffering and without reproach, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, hear the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
My friends in Christ, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you. Welcome once again to the American Cathedral in Paris. Bienvenue à la Cathédrale Episcopale de Paris. We are so glad once again that you have joined us on this seventh Sunday of the Easter season, the Sunday that comes immediately after the Ascension and before Pentecost. This is a time of transition, not just spiritually in our calendar, in our liturgical calendar, but also in the world as we're living through this pandemic right now. And so much about how we're living our lives, no matter where we are in the world, is either changing right now or about to change, as is the case here in Paris as we anticipate the beginning of lifting of restrictions that we've been living through for these last number of months. And there will be aspects of how we live our life in the days and weeks ahead that will continue to shift and evolve. So stay tuned to our website for information about how our common life will be adjusting in the coming days and weeks. One thing that we hope and anticipate may change by the time we worship next together, next Sunday, for the Feast of Pentecost, is that we will finally be able to make the shift from pre-recording our services that are available online for Sunday mornings to live streaming. And this is a powerful and important shift for us to make on this Feast of Pentecost for next week, when we will be celebrating the birthday of the church and a promise that the church as we live in and the promise of God's love extends beyond time and geography, something that we've been living into week in and week out throughout these pandemic times and worshiping in this way online. And also in the beauty of our worship next week, we will be welcoming five new Christians in through the sacrament of Holy Baptism. And this will be an opportunity for us to have unity as our worshiping community throughout the world, as well as throughout Paris and throughout France. So we invite you to join us for that. And we also mention it because it will, for those of you who have become accustomed to worshiping with us online, the way that you see and experience worship next week may look somewhat different than what you've become used to, but will bring us greater unity, and we're looking forward to it. We hope that you will find it to be that way. And we look forward to learning about your experience of online worship as we continue to worship this way throughout this next period of transition. So that's for next week and preparing for that. For this week, this very evening at 6 p.m. here online in this space, wherever you are watching it, starting 6 p.m. Paris time, we'll offer our next service of sung compline, a beautiful setting that prepares us for rest in the transition between the weekend and the start of the next week. We hope that you'll join us for that. As always, you can tune in through our website and refer to the bulletin that accompanies this online service to learn more about our cathedral life in the days and weeks ahead. All of our ministry, wherever and whenever it may reach you, all of it is supported by you. We need your support, both spiritually in your prayers and in your support and lifting us up in your prayers wherever you may be, and also by the substance of the contributions that come to us financially. These continue to be difficult times, and we understand that. We are living through that ourselves. But we ask and we invite you to give as generously as you possibly can to support our ministry so that this cathedral can continue to be a bright beacon of God's radical love and joy this week and for weeks and for generations yet to come. Welcome once again. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
All thanks and praise are yours, at all times and in all places, our true and loving God. Through Jesus Christ, your eternal word, the wisdom from on high, by whom you created all things. You laid the foundations of the world and enclosed the sea when it burst out from the womb. You brought forth all creatures of the earth and gave breath to humankind. Wondrous are you, Holy One of blessing. All you create is a sign of hope for our journey. And so as the morning stars sing your praises, we join the heavenly beings and all creation as we shout with joy. Creator of all, your word has never been silent. You called a people to yourself as a light to the nations. You delivered them from bondage and led them to a land of promise. Of your grace, you gave Jesus to be human, to share our life, to proclaim the coming of your holy reign, and give himself for us a fragrant offering. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, you have freed us from sin, brought us into your life, reconciled us to you, and restored us to the glory you intend for us. We thank you that on the night before he died for us, Jesus took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, broken for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, Jesus took the cup of wine, said the blessing, gave it to his friends, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for all, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And so, remembering all that was done for us, the cross, the tomb, the resurrection and ascension, longing for Christ's coming in glory, and presenting to you these gifts your earth has formed and human hands have made, we acclaim you, O Christ. Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restored our life. Christ Jesus, come in glory. Send your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts of bread and wine, that they may be for us the body and blood of your Christ. Grant that we, burning with your Spirit's power, may be a people of hope, justice, and love. Giver of life, draw us together in the body of Christ. And in the fullness of time, gather us with all your people into the joy of our true eternal home. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, we worship you, our God and Creator, in voices of unending praise. Blessed are you, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Dear friends in Christ, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. For those of you who join us from afar, confident in God's holy presence with us at all times, and in God's abundant love that knits us together as a single community of faith, we invite you now to join us in a spiritual communion, joining with those who will receive here. Lord Jesus, as you promise to be with us in the bread and wine that is your body and blood, grant that we may receive you spiritually today into our hearts, minds, and souls. Stay with us. Be our companion in the way. Kindle our hearts and awaken hope that we may know you and have confidence in your loving care, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us pray. God of abundance, you have fed us with the bread of life and cup of salvation. You have united us with Christ and one another, and you have made us one with all your people in heaven and on earth. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Christ our Savior. Amen. And now God the Sender, send us. God the Sent One, come with us. God the Strength of those who go, grant us grace and power, that we might walk with you and find those who seek you. And the blessing, the mercy, and grace of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you and those you love and pray for, in heaven and on earth, this day and always. Amen.
Amen. Let us go forth in the name of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.